The 12-volt power system has dominated under the hood for decades at this point, but automakers and their suppliers are trying to figure out how to harness even higher voltages, specifically 48-volt technology. These systems stand out because they can handle much higher levels of power and distribute it across thinner, lighter, and even lower-cost wiring harnesses. While it remains very early on in the shift to 48 volts, these components will likely play a central role in electric vehicles, where power from the battery is used to drive all the accessory functions. To learn more about the cost, the complexity, and some of the technical hurdles facing 48-volt technology, I reached out to Kirk Ulrey, and he is one of the experts on 48-volt power systems at Molex, which recently released a report on what engineers need to know about navigating all of these issues. So I wanted to start with the basic question of why the auto industry is shifting to 48-volt power systems and sort of what the technical advantages of it are.
We're looking at 48 volt in the overall terms of electrification. When we talk electrification, I try and get people to think outside of just the electric vehicle. There's so many more features in your vehicle today that are becoming electrified. The biggest example I use with people are things like power windows. You can't buy a car with roll-up windows anymore. So each one of these devices requires more electric budget. And if we go back to Ohm's law, V equals IR, when you increase your voltage by a factor of four, you increase the power by a factor of four. So today, if you have, say, a 200-watt system at 12 volts, when you go to 48 volt, that's now an 800-watt system. And that's one of the key value propositions, is you get more power by going to the higher voltage. The other side of that is, if you don't need the higher power, you can go to smaller wires, which are lighter, weigh less, and are easier to route, and primarily cost less. And we're seeing both of those value propositions in the vehicles today.
How is the shift to 48 volts changing the vehicle's internal architecture? It seems as though it may be the case that there's just more power electronics that need to convert the voltage to different levels and move it around the cars. Is it sort of as simple as that, or can you go into more detail about sort of the building blocks that are falling into place to make this work?
At its simplest point, yes, it's a matter of re-architecting the vehicle to get to the 48-volt system. Excuse me. One of the other things we're seeing is a shift to zonal architecture as we add more high-speed devices and more safety devices to a vehicle. What we've seen, there's currently one OEM that has a full 48-volt distributed architecture in their vehicle, and they've also gone to zonal architecture, where they have four zone controllers in the vehicle. And they distribute 48 volts throughout the vehicle. There's no longer a 12-volt primary voltage distribution system. And you're right, it gets a little more complex initially, because not all the devices that plug into that are available in 48 volt. So the 48-volt zone controllers do have step down to continue with the current crop of 12-volt systems. But the long-term goal is to have as many devices available in 48 volt as that becomes implemented throughout the vehicle.
Okay, so a lot of the auxiliary functions that are today running on 12 volt, the vision is to sort of migrate those over to 48 so you don't have to do all this voltage conversion.
Correct. And again, it's a long-term vision. We've had 12-volt systems have been in place since the 50s, so we're dealing with 70 years of inertia that have to be overcome.
Right.
And it's in my mind, it's going to be a little bit easier because we have more flexibility in terms of battery technologies, those types of things. And what we're seeing, again, going back to the one example of the electrified vehicle, what they're doing is they're going to the primary battery, and pulling a 48 volt feed out of the primary battery to drive everything at 48 volts. So there's no longer even a 12 volt battery in the system. The only concession, as I mentioned earlier, is that step down from 48 to 12 in the zone controllers.
Okay, so I think I've heard of this concept before of there being a sort of quote unquote virtual battery, virtual 48 volt battery that sort of is a power converter. Can you sort of talk about how that's sort of implemented?
Well, what we're seeing is it's actually a true 48 volt battery that they're putting in the system primarily as a backup.
Okay.
And due to advances in battery technologies, we're trying to get away from lead acid. We're going to different lithium. There are a host of battery technologies that I'm not exactly familiar with. But what we're seeing are the batteries can be lighter. You can change the shape of the battery. You're not locked into the standard size. And in this case, there is a 48 volt battery that's not necessarily virtual. It's there primarily as a backup. And
Okay.
think of it as kind of a uninterruptible power supply, if you will, for the zonal architecture. If anything catastrophic happens to the primary battery pack, which is typically 350 to 500 volts today, you still have that backup with the 48 volt so that all the systems in the vehicle continue to operate.
Okay. So that's, like you said, that is an actual battery. It's not a power supply yet today.
Correct.
Okay.
But I can see things like super capacitors as an example, that would end up replacing the battery, long term. As more and more OEMs get into the advantages of 48 volt and start shifting the architecture, you're going to see the suppliers of all the individual components kind of coming along to help implement these systems.
Right. So I wanted to, before we move on to, I guess, some of the challenges that this is raising, you mentioned a couple of times this concept of a distributed architecture, and I just wanted to know if you could maybe go into a little bit more detail about what that is and maybe define it for people who may not be familiar.
Today, we have what we call a distributed architecture in a vehicle, in that if you think about the individual systems in your vehicle, things like adaptive cruise control, backup sensors, blind spot monitoring, typically every one of those sensors goes to a separate individual controller. So the parking sensors are an example where we have sensors in the front bumper, sensors in the rear bumper, and those are all cabled directly to a control unit that's typically under the dashboard. Moving into zonal architecture, we have a zone con a controller in that zone. And the initial one is think four zone controllers, essentially the four corners of the vehicle. And every device in that corner goes to that zone controller. So what it does is simplifies the wiring, because as we get more and more of these electronic features, the wiring of vehicles becoming incredibly complex. And what we're trying to do is simplify that going forward. And that's the promise of the zonal architecture. The other thing is, as we get to more and more autonomous vehicles, the zonal architecture will be a key driving factor, because all of your safety systems can fit in there. Each one of the zone controllers has some redundancy, and then those zone controllers are only connected together by a high-speed Ethernet backplane, or backbone, sorry.
Okay, so that's interesting because I think when the zonal architecture is talked about, it's almost talked about more from the perspective of control, like you said, like for autonomous vehicles, unless you think you sort of think of it less in terms of the power architecture as well. So that's an interesting way to think about it. So the next question I wanted to ask was just about the some of the technical challenges. So, despite the promise of 48 volts, as you discussed, its adoption is still in the relatively early stages. You mentioned that only a single OEM is currently sort of moved to a 48 volt, a full volt 48 volt system. And so I'm wondering, what are the key technical challenges that stand out to you that are sort of holding this back?
Well, the biggest thing is the availability of 48 volt components.
Okay.
There are hundreds of individual components in every vehicle. And up until about 2 or 3 years ago, they were all designed around a 12 volt primary architecture. So it's a matter of switching those. And I kind of equate that back to in the 50s when they went from 6 volt to 12 volt. The advantage they had then was there were very few components. The biggest issue there were finding 12 volt light bulbs versus 6 volt light bulbs. So it was a relatively simple matter. But because we have so many electrified devices today, it's making that shift from everything operating at a 12 volt architecture as opposed to the 48 volt. But as people look at the advantages of that, I think that's going to outweigh the drawbacks. I do think it's going to be a little bit of time in order to do, in order to make the full transition. And some of the smaller OEMs are going to have an easier time. If you think about a large OEM that may have 20 global product lines or car lines, going throughout the world, they all use some of the same components. And it's a matter of making the change for all of those going forward. And that, I think, right now is one of the drawbacks.
So I'm sort of thinking about this from the perspective of an engineer, and obviously, you know, getting your hands on the 48 volt components is important, but are there any sort of challenges that stand out to you in terms of integrating those into the system?
I'm not as familiar with the mechanics of how they do a device system. As a connector manufacturer, we have quite a few regulatory requirements that we're bound to in order to make sure that our products are always safe going forward. In transportation systems, anything above 60 volts is considered a lethal voltage. And if you hear people in the automotive industry, they talk about orange connectors, orange cables. We mold all of those in a bright orange color to make sure that everyone understands that. But within the what we're calling mid voltage, which 48 volt is the standard that everyone talks about, technically it's between 20 and 60 volts is that mid voltage range. And in that system, we still have requirements that we have to deal with from a connector standpoint. We look at things like creepage and clearance, where creepage is how the voltage goes across a plastic, you know, the insulator between two terminals. Clearance has to do with the airspace between those terminals. And there are specific requirements that we have to meet going forward to make sure that from a regulatory standpoint, everything we do is safe and is not going to have issues with things like shorting and different issues that tend to happen at the higher voltages.
What opportunities for innovation do you sort of see for the future in this space? Are there any technical challenges that are especially tricky or unsolved with this? Or is it really just, you know, getting everyone on the same page with 48 volts and getting the components that you need to make the transition?
I think it is getting everyone on the same page. From a technical standpoint, there are some issues we have from a connector standpoint. One of the things that we're doing today is looking at all of our current product lines and evaluating them to the IEC and VDA specifications to make sure that we meet the requirements for mid-voltage. And I think that's going to be a key going forward as people look at smaller connectors and different things to help wiring in the vehicle. One of the examples that we use is Molex. If you look at a typical 12-volt vehicle architecture, you're driving about 80 amps of current at 12 volts. Going back to the original, you know, originally when we talked about the advantage of 48, by going to 48 volt, that drops to about a 20 amp system. And that's where the smaller terminals, smaller wires, lighter, you know, easier to route systems all come in. And that's just a start for us. As we look at our entire product portfolio and people add more electrified devices to their vehicle, we're evaluating all the connectors today and the products that we're designing in the future, where we want to make sure that they do work in the mid-voltage requirement for the transportation systems. From a design standpoint, it's fairly specific. It's definitely mechanical. We look at, you know, what's the distance, spacing, pin pitch, those kinds of things. But we're also evaluating some new materials. One of the things that we evaluate for our plastics, as an example, is CTI, which has to do with the way that the signal can transmit across the plastic. And we're looking for materials that are more resistive to that, which helps us when we get into smaller pitch connectors. The enemy of high voltage is connector pitch, if you will. If you look at, you know, the large orange connectors, you know, that are 500 to 1,000 volt systems, you need to make sure that you've got sufficient clearance so that you don't get arcing between them. Even for 48 volts, we have to worry about that. And that's with a lot of our smaller connectors, which can be, you know, a millimeter pitch, you know, which is the distance between the two pins.
So one of the topics we have yet to touch on is EMI. How is the shift to 48 volt technology impacting EMI? And what do engineers need to know about managing it?
Yeah, the EMI in electric vehicles is primarily related more to the higher voltage systems.
Okay.
If you look at the primary wiring systems, you know, again, the 500 volt to 300 amp systems, there's a lot of EMI that's radiated out of the cable, and most of those cables are shielded. When you get into the finer pitch systems and specifically to the mid voltage, you know, 20 to 60 volt range, today we don't have a lot of issues with EMI.
Okay.
as we get into the high speed, you know, I mentioned earlier the Ethernet backbone of the vehicle that connects those, all of those cable systems are shielded, and that's primarily to protect them from external or radiated emissions coming in, which would impact the signal. And again, if you're looking at more of an autonomous vehicle, you know, some of the driving systems we have today, you definitely want to make sure that those signals are completely protected as you're driving down the road to make sure that your autonomous vehicle doesn't suddenly throw a glitch into your system.
All right, Kirk. Well, thanks so much for taking the time to walk us through this.